Hey guys.
Hey, Bo.
Hi, Bo.
Flippin' physics.
Ladies and gentle people, the bell has rung, therefore class has begun, therefore you should be seated in your seat, ready and excited to figure out the average speed necessary for pole position.
Yep. Yes, absolutely. Let's do it.
All right, let's get right to the problem. Bobby, could you please read the problem?
During the 2010 Indianapolis 500, Helio Castro...
Yes, the name. I don't know the name either. Kate, could you please tell us how to pronounce it?
Helio Castro Neves.
Okay, let's just start over. During the 2010 Indianapolis 500, Helio Castro Neves won pole position by averaging 228.0 miles per hour, or MPH, for four 2.500 mile laps. If he averaged 222.0 miles per hour for the first two laps, what must his average speed have been for the last two laps? You may assume the number of laps is exact.
Good. Now let's translate to physics. Bobby, could you please read? And Billy, could you please translate?
During the 2010 Indianapolis 500, Helio Castro Neves won pole position by averaging 228.0 miles per hour for four 2.500 mile laps.
Please stop. Speed equals 228.0 miles per hour, and distance equals 10 miles.
Sure, the speed is 228.0 miles per hour, and the distance is equal to 10 miles. But notice I didn't write just the distance is equal to 10 miles. Instead, I wrote down the given value. It's always important to know what your knowns are, and a known in this particular case is that the distance per lap is 2.500 miles. Therefore, the distance traveled is going to be equal to 4 laps times 2.5 miles per lap, and therefore 10 total miles. Oh, and I use S for speed and D for distance. Bobby, please keep reading. If he averaged 222.0 miles per hour for the first two laps, what must his average speed have been for the last two laps? You may assume the number of laps is exact.
And speed equals 222.0 miles per hour, and distance equals 2 laps times 2.5 miles, or 5 miles.
We need subscripts, because we can't have the same variable equal to different numbers. That doesn't make any sense.
Bo, you are correct. We do need subscripts. And, Bo, what do you think those subscripts should be?
228 is the first speed, so put a subscript of 1 on it, and 222 is the second, so put a subscript of 2 on that one.
Actually, I think the 228 miles per hour is not part of the trip, but actually for the whole trip, the whole thing. So you should use T for total for the speed for 228 miles per hour. The same is true for the 10 miles. That distance should be distance sub T for the total trip. That means that the 222 miles per hour is just for the first part, so put speed sub 1. And then the 5 miles, that distance would be distance 1. We don't actually have what we're trying to find on the board yet. Billy, could you tell me, what are we trying to find?
We are trying to find the average speed for the second part. So write speed 2, or S sub 2, is equal to question mark.
Good. Now we have all the known values on the board and what we're trying to find. One thing I'm going to do now is I'm going to draw a visual that's going to help people understand what's going on here. I always love visuals. All right, I know the track for the Indy 500 is actually an oval. However, it's much harder to visualize if we draw it as an oval, so I've just drawn it as a straight line, which works out fine. You can see we have the total track. I've split that into parts 1 and part 2 for the first two laps and the second two laps. You can see that we know the average speed total and the distance total. We know the average speed for part 1 and the distance for part 1. We also know the distance for part 2, but the one thing we don't know is the average speed for part 2, which is what we're trying to find. Bobby, what would you like to do next?
Well, let's start with the equation. Let's start with the equation for speed. Speed equals distance over time.
The equation is always a great place to start. In this particular case, speed equals distance over time, or S equals D over T, just using the letters. You can see that we know a lot of speeds and we know a lot of distances, but we don't know any times. Bo, what do you think we should do next?
We need to solve for time. We could multiply both sides by time to cancel out time on the right-hand side. That leaves us with time multiplied by speed, and that's equal to distance. Then we could divide both sides by speed to cancel out speed on the left-hand side. And that leaves us with time is equal to distance divided by speed.
Very nice, Bo. You can see we have speed equals distance over time, and our goal is to actually solve for time because that's the one thing we don't really know. So we multiply both sides by time. Time cancels out on the right-hand side. We're left with time times speed is equal to the distance. Therefore, we can divide both sides by the average speed, and we end up with the average speed canceling out on the left-hand side. We end up with the time is equal to the distance traveled divided by the average speed. Now we can look at specifics. Let's look at part one, for example. So we have all the information we need for part one, so we can just put in a one for our subscripts. We have time one is equal to distance one divided by average speed one. And the distance for part one was 5 miles, and the average speed for part one was 222 miles per hour. Therefore, what do we get for our time for part one? 0.0225225 kilometers per, no, not kilometers, miles per hour. No, I can't, no, that's not. What are the dimensions? That is a great question. We need to figure out the dimensions for time for part one. I find that a lot of students do get confused by this, so let's walk our way through solving for the dimensions for time for part one. So we know time equals the distance divided by the average speed, so we can just substitute in the dimensions for those. The distance is in miles, and the average speed is in miles per hour. In order to solve this, to figure out what this actually represents, we need to harken back a few years to a phrase that you probably remember, which is flip the guy and multiply. That's right, flip the guy and multiply. Oh yeah.
I don't think I've ever heard of that.
The guy that we need to flip and multiply is miles per hour. Therefore, we flip him, we get hours over miles, and we multiply by what's on top. Now, what we have on top is actually miles over one. Which means we end up with miles over one times hours over miles. The miles cancel out and we end up with hours. So we get 0.0225225 hours for our time for part one. We can now do the same thing for the total trip. So you can see for the total trip, we're going to get the time total is equal to the distance total divided by the average speed total. The distance total was 10 miles, and the average speed total was 228 miles per hour. Therefore, the time for the total trip is 0.0438596 hours. Great. Now that we figured out the time for part one and the time total, I want to make sure we understand what these numbers actually represent. Bo, please tell me, what do these two numbers actually represent?
Well, 0.0225225 hours is the time that the guy spent driving at 222 miles per hour, and 0.0438596 hours is the time that the guy spent driving at 228 miles per hour.
Bo, that's pretty close, and I do want to elaborate on it, though. This time, the time for part one, 0.0225225 hours, this is the time where he averaged 222 miles per hour. He didn't actually go that speed that whole time. We just know that he averaged that amount of speed during that time. And we used this many hours for part one. In addition to that, we know that this is the total time that we can use for the four laps or 10 miles. And again, we know we need to average 228 miles per hour for that time, but we're not gonna travel at exactly 228 miles per hour. It's an average time. So this is the total time that we could have possible. If we have more time than this, if it takes him more time than this, then we're actually going to average less than 228 miles per hour, and we're not, he's not going to get pole position. And so, Bobby, what next?
Oh, we can figure out the time for part two now.
Yeah, it's just 0.0438596 minus the 0.0225225.
Careful. Please remember, always start with an equation. We know that the total time is equal to the time for part one plus the time for part two. Therefore, we can subtract the time for part one from both sides. We get that the time for part two is equal to the total time minus the time for part one. Therefore, the time for part two is going to be equal to 0.0438596 hours minus 0.0225225 hours. So time two is 0.0213371 hours. Again, just to make sure we fully understand what this time represents, Bobby, please tell me, what does 0.0213371 hours represent?
0.0213371 hours. That's the time for part two, or the time left for the remaining two laps, such that Elio Castroneves can average 228 miles per hour.
Exactly.
What now, Bo? We could go back to the original equation for speed. Speed equals distance over time, because we know the distance for part two and the time for part two, so we can substitute the information for part two and solve for the speed for part two.
So you can see, now that we have the time for part two, we can figure out the speed for part two. It's just gonna be the distance for part two divided by the time for part two. So the average speed for part two is just gonna be 5 miles divided by 0.0213371 hours. Now, before we solve for this number, I wanna take a moment and just think about the way students often look at this problem. So going back to the very beginning, students often look at this and say, well, we need to average 228 miles per hour. And for the first half, we averaged 222 miles per hour, which is 6 miles per hour less than 228 miles per hour. Therefore, for the second half, we must average
6 miles per hour more for the second half. That would be 234 miles per hour, but something tells me that's not right because you're asking the question.
Bo, you are correct that this is incorrect. This basic idea comes from here. Regardless of the fact that we went through this a couple of lessons ago, students still have this idea that the average speed is going to be equal to the speed for part one plus the speed for part two divided that by two. In other words, 228 is equal to 222 plus the speed for part two divided by two. Multiply both sides by two, we get 2 times 228 is equal to 222 plus this average speed for part two. Therefore, subtracting 222 miles per hour from both sides, we get the average speed for part two is equal to 2 times 228 minus 222, which gives you the average speed for part two would be 234.0 miles per hour. But again, this is not correct. What do we actually get for our average speed for part two by solving this problem correctly? 234.333 miles per hour, which rounds with four sig figs to 234.3 miles per hour. And we don't need direction, because this is speed and not velocity. Note, again, 234.0 is not the same thing as 243.3 miles per hour. In other words, this is not correct. You can't add the two speeds together and divide by two to get the average speed. When is the only time that this actually works where you can add the two speeds together and divide by two to get the average speed, please? Bobby, when is that true?
I think that's only when the object is moving at those speeds for the same amount of time. In this problem, it's the same distance, which clearly is very different.
Great. Please remember, you can only do this when it's for the same amount of time, not the same amount of distance. Ladies and gentlemen, people, so ends my...
Hang on. I have a question. Why did we give our answer with four significant digits? Shouldn't it have just been one? The total distance only had one sig fig, and the same is true for distance for parts one and two. 10 miles and 5 miles. Each of those only have one sig fig.
Okay, that's a good question. Billy, Bo, what do you guys think?
Those distances weren't given values. They weren't knowns. The distance per lap was the known value, and then that had four sig figs in it. The total distance and the distances for parts one and two were derived from the distance per lap. So we have to go back to the sig fig for the knowns, not the sig figs for the derived values. Go all the way back to the knowns.
Yes, please note that I always write down our givens. We need to always do that. With the correct number of sig figs, but we don't have to carry the correct number of sig figs throughout the problem. You simply have the correct sig number of sig figs at the very beginning and at the very end. Oh, and speaking of sig figs, one thing I do have to confess is that Elio Castroneves in 2010 in the Indy 500 actually qualified for pole position with a speed of 227.970 miles per hour. They actually carry their... they figure out their average speeds to 6 sig figs, which makes sense. I cut it down to 4 sig figs, so it would be easier to show that this is incorrect, which is an important piece. I hope that's okay with you.
Sure, doesn't bother me.
Okay, I guess that makes sense. All right, that was my example problem, figuring out the average speed necessary to qualify for pole position. I hope you enjoyed learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.
Lecture notes.
are available at flippingphysics.com. Please enjoy lecture notes responsibly.
Ooh, 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 ooh.